Hello and welcome to this week's Force Friday show, where we're going to be discussing and breaking down The Rise of Skywalker. That's coming up next.
Yes, Stephen, this is indeed going to be our spoilerific review for The Rise of Skywalker. We went to see the movie last Sunday,
yeah,
and we decided very deliberately not to jump right in and review the movie too soon, because we did this back with obviously The Last Jedi. It didn't age well, I have to say. Subsequent viewings, in my case just one more, taught me that the movie wasn't as good as I first had envisaged when I watched it. And that the actual experience of going to watch this movie actually outweighed the sum of the actual artistic stuff going on in the movie. So, we have delayed it a good week. We have
I think I forgot about it.
We've let it set in.
Yeah.
And I've still get pretty much the same opinion of this movie, Stephen. It wasn't amazing by any means. I gave it a solid 6.5 out of 10 if I was rating it.
Yeah.
And it wasn't shit either. It was somewhere in between. Probably close to shit, knowing truth. But look, I suppose we'll break it down in more depth, Stephen. I have got a brief little outline which we'll try and adhere to, but what if it goes off on a tangent? Tangents are happy little surprises. Bob Ross says, happy little tree. I'll say happy little surprise.
Yeah.
Opening crawl and intro, Stephen. That's the first thing. What was your thoughts on that opening crawl? Because
the dead speak, yeah.
Yeah, the dead speak. He hits it home right away, yeah. JJ. The dead speaketh. Apparently, good old Chief Palpatine has been sending voice messages out to the greater galaxy. I've wrote here, why? Yeah. Why is the Emperor sending out a message?
What an introduction, for someone that's a Phantom Menace, he was very flamboyant in his introduction into this generation.
Hey everybody, I'm here.
Yeah, I'm here, don't forget about me. But I think, John, when it comes to opening crawls, I don't really pay too much attention to them. The good ones, I don't really remember. The bad ones I do. War, as you remember from episode 3.
What was it, episode 3?
It's something that doesn't really... the whole film doesn't hinge on that, as far as I'm concerned. You know, it's always nice to get an open crawl. When you look at the likes of the standalones like Solo and Rogue One, there's always something missing there. It's part of Star Wars. But if I'm being honest, you know, I kind of just skimmed over the reading of it, because it doesn't really tell you much, and it shouldn't really tell you much. It's really just sort of reminding you where we're at. I think we'll just get right into that why question, John, about Palpatine's reveal to the galaxy. I think it was really just cutting corners from a narrative point of view, you know. Cinematically and, you know, from an artistic point of view, I think it could have been done better. You know, I think his reveal would have been...
very early, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Very early reveal.
But then you think back to that trailer that we got back in April. That was a reveal that Palpatine was back with the laugh, and then Ian McDermott being on stage at Celebration. So there was no surprise in regards to that. That's something I felt they perhaps should have... kept a secret, but I don't think they had a lot of faith in the decision of introducing Palpatine back into the franchise at that point. I think they wanted to put their feet in the water, really test the audience's reaction to his return.
Yeah.
At Celebration, it obviously was a welcome return. A lot of people out with Celebration scratching their head, what are they playing at here?
Yeah.
Well, we all knew, John, after Snoke's demise in The Last Jedi, something had to give.
And he's a clone.
Little
Snoke's in that. The
voices as well. That explained it well, is to be honest with you. I thought that was a pretty cool trick, you know, having James Earl Jones' voice and Andy Serkis' voice all delivering that one line. So from that point of view, the introduction of the crawl, and obviously we get the sort of sequence from Kylo Ren's point of view, the pace of it took me by surprise. But I get where J.J. Abrams was coming from, and wanting to get to his story as quickly as possible. Yeah. A lot of people obviously have accused him of retconning a lot of the things from The Last Jedi. I think he wanted to really move the story in his direction as quickly as possible. Some might say that it was retconning. It was to a degree. But I think when the film's duration, which we talked about last week, being 2 hours and 20 minutes, I think, something like that. We knew that first half hour was going to be frantic.
It was, Stephen. I've actually wrote that in my little list. Very frantic first act. A lot of choppy jumps. I never really thought that a Star Wars movie could become more frantic and more choppy than what we got with Rogue One. Obviously, that was a disaster behind the scenes. Yeah. Gareth Edwards just created a turd, I think, in the main. Tony Gilroy had to come in, save the day. And you really seen that in the opening half an hour of that movie. Lots of chops. I think it was about 6 or 7 planet jumps in the beginning of Rogue One. It's the same here. So that's maybe indicative of some issues behind the scenes with JJ and what he had. There was obviously speculation that there was 4, 5, 6 cuts of this movie. That was more in line with the ending, though, not the beginning.
Yeah.
A lot of people had complaints about the first hour of this movie, saying it was all over the place, it felt bloated, lots of exposition, jumps all over the shot. I actually didn't mind the actual opening hour of this movie at all. I thought the whole movie was hectic.
Yeah.
It was all over the place anyway, so I didn't mind seeing. I've always maintained one of my favourite things about Star Wars is going to different locations, different planets, seeing different species and whatnot. We certainly get that in the opening half hour of this movie. Kylo wrecking shot on that wooded planet, just killing those strange little alien creatures. He gets his hands on a wayfinder.
That's right,
I think it's Exegol, I want to say. He goes and
Exegol.
Visits.
Exegol.
Goes and visits, obviously, Sheev Palpatine. We get that cool shot where it's black, it's dark, and he's flitting out between lightning shots. You can see he's got white eyes. He's speaking about, you'll get the final order fleet if you kill Rey or something, that you get the scavenger.
Yeah.
Then that takes us off. We've got numerous different introductory scenes. Poe and Finn and whatnot going to get intel on that strange icicle planet, iceberg.
Yeah.
And then we get the training montage, and I've got that there as well, Stephen. What did you make of Rey's very brief training montage? It seems to be in line with what we've seen in other Star Wars movies. A 5-minute training montage, which just explains why she's so powerful now, because you actually nearly swore, I think you actually did swear, during that moment where she had about 20 rocks. It's almost like,
I think it was a FFS,
Luke dangles a rock with Yoda on his back, Rey can dangle 50 rocks with BB-8 beside her.
Yeah, but all she's missing was juggling, John. I think, at first I was rolling my eyes at that, I've got to be honest, John. I think once I saw the shot of Leia being in her presence, it kind of, it made me accept it a little bit more. You know, I still think it's a bit over the top, but it's when you look at the progression of Luke Skywalker from episode 5 to 6, we get that sort of very subtle motion he gives the Gamorrean guards in Jabba's palace of the Force choke. We know that he's developed his powers. He's, you know, dabbling a bit on, you know, the dark side there. With this, it was more this was more visual, you know. It was very fairy tale looking as well, the way it was shot. It was very bright, you know, and colourful, and the way she was just sort of hovering, the way she came down as well from being up there, she did a kind of a somersault slow thing going on, and I was like, oh, come on, you know. But once I saw Leia, you know, I think it kind of made it a bit more acceptable to me, because I've always regarded Leia, I don't want to say as powerful, but as probably as knowledgeable in the Force as Luke is at that stage in their lives. We get that, obviously, that flashback, you know, later on in the film, which I'm sure we'll talk about, but it kind of gives you that sort of, you know, perspective and balance, and where both Luke and Leia were in the Force at that stage in their lives. I think they were 58 or something like that by the time of their passing. So, Luke would have been, I don't know, Luke might have been a little bit younger, because he died a few years before, obviously, the events of The Last Jedi.
I think it was a year. So
a year, is it, John?
57,
it didn't bother me as much once I saw Leia. I think that kind of made it more acceptable, to be honest with you. Just getting back to that other thing you talked about there, John, with Palpatine saying to Kylo Ren to kill the scavenger. It's a bit of a contradiction, and maybe I've picked it up wrong because I've only seen the film once, but he needed Rey at the very end of the film to, you know, consume him, and he's to consume her to become one.
Yeah.
So why would he want to kill her at the start, and then at the end he needs her to kill him? I
think that was just Sheev being a facetious little shit. Can I even get once again, Stephen?
Yeah.
Doing what he did to Count Dooku in the prequel trilogy.
Yeah,
saying, I need you, and then as soon as he's disposable, he gets rid of him.
That look that Dooku gives him when he says, kill him now, you know, as if you're...
It's as if you treacherous shit. Well, you should have seen it coming, Count.
Yeah.
Or Darth Tyranus, as you were going by at that point. But yeah, I think that was just him saying, look, if you kill her, the final order's yours. You can assume the throne and be the Emperor and take my place. But then once she actually appeared on his doorstep, right in front of him at the throne, he changed his tune and decided, well, look, you are my granddaughter. you can take over as the Empress, I think he says, Palpatine.
Yeah.
But yeah, I agree with you, Stephen, about the action training montage. After I seen Leia there, it was apparent she had spent quite a bit of time before, after the events of The Last Jedi. Wasn't too bothered about the rocks either. We have already seen her lift numerous rocks at the end of The Last Jedi as well, and create. And just the fact she had access to the Jedi scrolls is what and whatnot as well, those ancient scrolls from obviously Act 2, she's probably been diving into it like a little bookworm. Certainly Poe and Finn hint at it, that she's been spending too much time away training.
Yeah,
they need her there because she's the best fighter they have. And that actually gets me onto that next, but what did you make of Poe and Finn's introduction as well, Stephen? Then just the introductions as a whole. Just
This is when it was confirmed there was a spy, wasn't
it?
I thought those force skips or whatever they're called were pretty cool. A lot better than the sort of space thing that was going on in The Last Jedi with the fuel thing. But yeah, it was pretty cool the way it was shot. Obviously the visuals, I don't really want to get too much into it, John, because I always think it's an easy way to describe a bad film by saying it's got nice visuals. Star Wars films have always got nice visuals. Even the prequels, to an extent, with all the green screen, have got nice visuals. A bit dated now, but they did have nice visuals for the day.
And ironically, was the sand falling on a black background?
Yeah.
On feet in the boo, which looked the best.
Yeah.
So there you go.
And Anakin doesn't like that. He doesn't like water because it is really sand. But yeah. I thought that was good. It was good to see the chemistry between the two characters back as well that we got from The Force Awakens. So, it was evidently missing in The Last Jedi, but there was reasons for that. You know, obviously the gang had been split up to do their own thing, so we didn't get that chemistry that we got in The Force Awakens, which always reminded me of the Han, Luke and Leia chemistry from the original trilogy. That sort of humour in the face of death. Yeah. You know, it was always there. And I thought John Boyega in The Force Awakens, you know, his chemistry with Harrison Ford as well was superb. So it was good to see that chemistry back. Poe Dameron, he's not... I thought he'd get a bit mistreated in The Last Jedi as well, you know, from certain people, you know, pointing fingers at him with purple hair. But I thought the chemistry was back. So it was a good introduction. We got the chess piece as well, you know, the hollow chess, you know, so the humour was there right away, you know.
If he continued to get fooled by that same move, then we knew that Chewie was just something not ringing true.
Yeah.
Which we got, obviously, in behind the scenes shots of Peter Mayhew shouting, "Where are you going?" and things like that. We knew he had a screw loose. Yeah, Stephen, what is your thoughts, though, on the actual planets as well? Because we also see numerous jumps in that first act, as we did allude to.
Yeah.
Did you have a particular planet which you thought was your favourite, be it Exico, whatever it's called, that desert planet with the festival?
My personal favourite,
the actual snowy planet at night. It was, I heard someone say it was reminiscent of World War II. They're sneaking around. Also, there was a good humorous moment as well with C-3PO having the cloak over his head.
Snow troopers
kicking around. We get Zori Bliss introduced. Yeah. Which was just a completely unnecessary character, really. She handed over some captain's medallion, which allowed them to go on to Kylo Ren's Star Destroyer. That was convenient.
Yeah.
That's another thing, Stephen. So many convenient things happen in the first 35, 40 minutes of this movie. They go off to the desert planet. They just so happen to meet Lando Calrissian, which clearly wasn't Billy Dee Williams initially, incidentally. Moving way too easily.
Yeah.
That guy has a cane in real life.
Yeah.
They just so happen to go out after that neat little speeder chase and fall into quicksand and then fall down right onto the dagger they needed. Then they just so happened to showcase, obviously, Rey's healing powers, which is one of those new powers that, obviously, your man JJ says would happen and it would probably anger some fans. Now I know what he's speaking about. That didn't really bother me, incidentally. The healing power.
Yeah.
I was more annoyed by the moment where she clutched the shuttle out of the air, actually shouted, "For sake."
Yeah, yeah.
And then, obviously, there's a double buff. But what... favourite planet, and what was your thoughts on...
I don't know what the planet's called, John, but I think it's no one as well. The sand planet, again, we've seen it before with Tatooine and Jakku. The only good thing about that was obviously that sort of speeder chase, the sail barge things, I don't know what they're called.
Yeah,
well, C-3PO said they fly now, and then Boyega said they fly now, and then Poe said they fly now. So, it was a good sequence. We saw part of it, obviously, in the trailer, but... it's always those scenes you get in a Star Wars film, whether it be speeder bikes in Endor Forest, that's very similar, you know, the high pace and what's at stake as well. I didn't mind the flying troopers either. I thought that's something they probably should have had. They had it in the game, if you recall, with Battlefront. The first one, you know, for the PlayStation.
Yeah.
PlayStation 2, I think it was, back in the day. So it's something that's been there before, and it was good to see it, obviously, in a film. Just getting back, John, to what you're saying about the planets as well. They weren't that memorable, the ones that were, you know, within the skips, you know, the actual skips. Yeah, I don't know what planets they were.
It's like the underside of Cloud City.
That's what I was going to say. That one, obviously, with the pillars, did remind me of Cloud City. So I think overall, the sand one just was... I don't know why they didn't just make it Tatooine, to be honest with you, you know, or Jakku.
why was the master ship still sitting on that plateau, untouched?
Yeah.
And it's already been established that Jawas and whatnot will go in and scavenge every single little intricate mechanical part, and yet this thing's still sitting, still airworthy.
Yeah, we saw it in The Mandalorian, John, so I don't know why it didn't happen. And it wasn't even like it was hidden away in a cave or anything. It was just sitting there. And Rey recognised the ship, obviously, you know, but she couldn't place it. And back to, obviously, the force pull thing you were talking about, the double bluff, John. You made a good point. I didn't pick it up initially. I thought, what the hell have they done to Chewbacca? I thought, that's the lowest of a low. As if, you know, losing Han, Luke and Leia wasn't bad enough. Losing Chewie in that fashion would have been unacceptable. But you did make a good point, you know, that there is a scene in the trailer. It's obviously later on in the film with Lando and Chewie in the Falcon cockpit. So if I had that in mind, I wouldn't have panicked as much. But yeah, you know, I thought visually it was a good... there I go again, the visuals. But... what I mean by that is obviously the lightning coming out of Rey. That kind of shocked me a little bit.
Yeah.
I didn't think she was capable of that at this stage.
That's
why I don't think that, because the way they've handled this character, she can do anything. I just didn't expect that to happen from her, because at this point, I don't think the reveal was obviously, you know, in the story at this point.
No, Kylo had been hinted at, obviously the Emperor says to him, I'll reveal who she really is or something like that. So he was trying to...
cuts away, that's right.
Yeah, he was trying to force it out just to confirm in his mind she actually is connected to Palpatine. So that was neat. Actually, before that as well, Stephen, we get the Knights of Ren introduced as well, just doing what they do in this movie, which is appearing ominously.
Old shovels and stuff like that.
Old shovels appearing at the corner of the screen, looking out and then doing nothing.
Yeah.
Then they obviously spot Chewie, they grab him, take him away with a dagger. But then we get that cool moment we've seen in the trailer where Kylo is also piloting these TIE. I can't recall the actual name.
Interceptor.
Interceptor, that's a great word.
Yeah.
And then also Rey flips over. That was such a cool sequence. Just the sound of his ship in the distance coming. And then she slices the wing off. Yeah. And they have a brief stare down and then they go off. There's lots of moments like that. It's just five minutes or something in the scene and then off quick.
I think from that point as well, when we get the Force lightning coming out of her hands, I think even Kylo Ren's a little bit shocked at that point. You know, he kind of backs off as if, I didn't realise she was this powerful, so it was pretty cool.
Yeah, I knew she was that powerful, Stephen. As you did say, she can do everything, really. Yeah. But yeah, Stephen, we then move on to the ice planet, snow planet. We have that great sequence with Zori Bus and whatnot. It reveals, obviously, Poe is, in fact, a spice smuggler.
Yeah.
We get some in-between joking between him and Finn again, as you hinted to, great chemistry there. Although, what I will say, and I was going to get into it later on, but I felt what the characters out with of Kylo, the Emperor, and actually Rey are completely superfluous to this story. It was much like Han in Return of the Jedi. You could have took every single one out, and the story would have continued just unabated, really, and it wouldn't have changed much. Poe and Finn did nothing really to affect the actual arc of Rey. She just did her own thing. Much so that she actually went across in the skimmer when she got to Endor.
I lost count as well, John, the amount of times that Finn had shouted the word Rey out. It must have been about 7 or 8 times in the first hour.
That was an audio.
Yeah.
Just hint at these guys don't mean nothing. They were useless. It was like Han, as I did say, on Endor.
Yeah.
Could have killed them off. Finn should have sacrificed himself on Crate, and we shouldn't have had that moment at all. We should have been going as we say before. We had that before. But yes, Stephen, we'll not get down a rabbit hole. I'll move on swiftly to what I was going to say. We have that great, obviously, battle between Kylo and Rey on his Star Destroyer. It's revealed what her lineage is in the hangar afterwards.
Yeah.
We have so much going on in that sequence. What was your thoughts on that? I actually liked the coming and going between the planet and his ship. the obviously lightsaber battle.
Yeah.
Then we have General Hux reveal himself to indeed be
not the biggest kept secret, was it? Yes.
Yeah. And then General Pride, played by Richard E. Grant, obviously kills him, just shoots him. What was your thoughts on that in general, that whole sequence? What was your thoughts on me continuing Finn Foe as well?
Going back, John, in hindsight, I would have probably liked to have seen Richard E. Grant's character probably playing the role of Hux in The Force Awakens. Yeah,
that would have been cool.
Rather than Domhnall Gleeson. But the point you get to, the time you get to The Last Jedi, the characters is more or less just comic relief, which was sad because it could have been so much more. I think that's why...
Shoot him in the arm.
Yeah, I think... shot him in the leg, didn't it? But I think... I think that's why Richard E. Grant's character, Pride, did you say? Was introduced to give a bit more seriousness to the sort of commanding officer because, you know, I think Hux was just a joke figure in the episode before, and they couldn't really go back to making him a serious character after that. So it was pretty obvious, you know, he was going to be the spy. You know, there was obviously, that was one of the leaks I'm pretty sure we knew about 4 months ago. There was going to be someone in the First Order that was going to be sort of, you know,
it was General Hux.
And we predicted it was going to be him anyway. So, and you know, I think Poe and Finn actually say we knew it. Well, we did. We certainly knew it.
Yeah.
But I think, I mean, it's one of those... And I liked the Richard E. Grant character as well. I thought he's such a softly spoken actor. You know, whatever he's in, he was in Logan. He was the antagonist in that as well. And he always plays the role convincingly, despite his very soft tones, you know. He's very menacing. I think the only thing
adds a layer of malevolence. It's like Peter Cushing. Yes. It's obviously Grand Moff Tarkin. Yeah. The softly spoken English chap, but he's just to get that obviously edge to him, and he'll do what's necessary.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
But yeah, Stephen, I've really enjoyed the actual lightsaber battles in this movie as a whole as well. Just getting onto that quickly, but my favourite one was probably on the Death Star ruins. But the one prior to that in the room, we both spoke about it. It was very cool the way that they managed to almost cut it in a way where she's on the snow planet with Kyle, then it's back onto obviously his head, his quarters on the ship.
The face timing thing or whatever they call it, John.
It was dialed up, but it was done well, I thought.
I felt it was. I think that the, you know, the sort of involving the, you know, when the lightsabers clashed with whatever was in that marketplace that, you know, and then they appeared on the floor of Kylo's quarters.
Yeah,
that was pretty cool. I liked that, and obviously liked the way that
I
think it was Vader's mask. It fell onto the floor, but it fell onto the floor where he was, so he knew exactly where she was. So I think, you know, it was one of the better things. It was a bit jarring at first in The Last Jedi when it was introduced because we'd never seen it before, but visually it was very well done.
Yeah, and then obviously it's revealed that she is indeed the granddaughter of Palpatine.
Yeah.
Very matter-of-factly, he's using this as a way to try and bring her onto his side once again. He puts a hand out to her, she refuses again, jumps onto the Millennium Falcon, and then they go off to Endor, and we meet the horse people.
Yeah.
Obviously a defected platoon of stormtroopers. Poe and Finn, that's their names, not Foe. Then have
Pin,
their
thing.
Foe and Pin, they have their thing. Finn's absolutely elated. He's not the only defector in the galaxy.
Yeah.
He immediately has a bond with that character. Then Rey buggers off to the Death Star ruins, and she has a very cool little sequence. Again, showing her scavenging site from Jakku. She's climbing up. Then she goes into the headquarters off of the side of also the throne room, and has that moment with the flash forward. I want to see what could happen if she turns dark, Rey. Now, some people suggested she was actually sniggering during that scene, the dark Rey. She couldn't even take it serious, the actress herself. I didn't notice it, Stephen. I've only seen it once. But what was your thoughts on that before the encounter? And then obviously getting into that more long battle on the Death Star ruins. I'm sure I've missed something in between. Perhaps Domhnall Gleeson being... not Domhnall Gleeson, Dominic Monaghan being introduced again. What was the point of that character?
Side character.
What
he does. He has much importance in this as Carrie Fisher's daughter.
She had a great moment, by the way, when she called the general.
Yeah, I mean, I think we should talk about
that
as well,
that was
John,
something
in regards
to
Carrie Fisher's involvement in the film. I think the first 40 minutes, which we talked about, the way it was kind of all over the place was due to the fact that they had to try and work around what they had.
Yeah.
I felt the character and her presence in the film was a little odd, but I can forgive them for that because of the limited footage that they did have from The Force Awakens. At times, and someone said this online, I can't remember who it was, but it did feel like that. Those characters you get in perhaps like GTA, you know, the characters like a shopkeeper where they talk and you walk away and they're still talking.
Yeah.
That kind of lifelessness about them. And I mean that, and I don't mean that in a disrespectful way. Obviously, it's very hard for actors to come in. Rotoscoping, I felt they did well with it. I felt, you know, putting like the likes of the Rose character in the background of Leia, who both actors never worked together. Or they didn't have any shared scenes in The Last Jedi, I'm not sure.
Yeah.
And certainly, obviously, your man, Dominic Monaghan.
No, definitely, not.
Definitely didn't, but he was also in a scene, a same shot, if you know what I mean.
There's a great moment with Snap Wexley as well.
Well, I think that was shot from The Force Awakens. Yeah. I think that's why the character was asked back, John, so they can utilise that scene again.
Because then he dies at the end. Definitely dies this time because you see also
Paul. And it was the most annoying thing about that scene was that seconds after it, the rebels all turn up. They just hung on for 10 seconds.
It's like survived. Pawkins all over again. Where was Han?
Yeah.
And Pawkins was meeting his demise. Exactly. But yes, Dean, we were supposed to speak about that. You bailed me out. The implementation of Leia into this movie, I agree with you. I felt like it was handled well in the main, but it was jarring. Visually, you could tell she wasn't quite there. It was just empty, in a sense.
Yeah.
You could tell the actual actors still here were acting to nothing. I mean, they did as well as they could, JJ. I think that's something you hinted at there. First 40 minutes were spent really trying to include her character in a meaningful way.
Yeah.
But not just that. I think you spent the first 40 minutes, as you also alluded to right at the start, just try to tie up some of the things that happened in The Last Jedi, which he clearly didn't agree with in terms of tonally continuing from The Force Awakens, in terms of overarching story in this trilogy. We sorted that out as quickly as you could. It felt quite rushed. Then you get into the middle of the second half and continued on with his vision of what he's seen the characters doing in terms of, well, in this movie anyway, where he was forced. So yeah, I agree with you. That was pretty rushed in the main and had to work around her presence, but I thought they handled it well. And then obviously getting into that lightsaber battle on the Death Star ruin, she has a big moment there. We were concerned how they would let this character go out, and I felt like they handled that pretty damn well. Yeah. I have to say, with her becoming one with the Force, and then did she create that vision that Kylo sees after he's stabbed and Rey goes off after healing him?
It's going to be one of those situations, those scenes that are always going to be up in the air. It's not quite explained, and I suppose the audience member can take their own interpretation of it. Whether it be a memory of Ben Solo, or whether it be, you know, a kind of force projection, memory that's been sort of forced upon him, pardon the pun, by Leia. There was a line just before she, I think it was before she just passed away.
It was masking out, wasn't it? You know what you have to do now.
Yeah, and obviously it's going to take, obviously, what obviously cost Luke's life using the Force one more time when you're very weak.
Yeah.
So I thought it was cool. And I thought the introduction as well for Harrison Ford was a surprise. I never thought he would be back again because... It was a bit of a wigget, John. and it did look a little older. Obviously, this is 3 years after his last stint at Han Solo, so he's not getting any younger, but he's still got the same jacket.
He has, same jacket. Yeah. Different hairdo, though.
Yeah.
I don't know if it was a wig, Stephen. It may have been long hair. And he just says, you know what? I'm coming back. You should be happy enough that I am present. Yeah. Obviously, gracing you with my presence. I ain't cutting my hair. And look, Stephen, I can imagine he'd actually say that to, obviously, JJ and whatnot. But look, we do have that moment. The two of them fight. Finally, we get some action between these two characters where they're both very much at their prime. They're both fit and healthy. And all those little bitches who were whinging about Kylo being taken down by a fairly green-nosed fledgling Jedi. Well, you get your comeuppance here because Kylo does overpower Rey. He slaps her about like an empty tracksuit, as we say here. Obviously, he's about to strike her down when obviously Leia does shout Ben.
He drops her saber, and she grabs it and does a very dirty move.
Yeah, and stabs him, and it's almost like flipping the two. Yeah. The traditional good character turns bad briefly. Yeah. Then she realises that he's been tricked by Leia.
Yeah.
She maybe senses a change within him and heals him again. So that was handy that we got to see that healing power.
Well, that's why we saw it in that snake, John. Yeah, I mean, it was such a pointless... Well,
no, that Stephen, you know what that snake put me in mind of? See that big hideous thing we seen at the beginning of Soul? that creature within in the light obviously burns it. That's what it was like. It was
I mean, it was one of those scenes that was so set up and so obvious why it was set up as well. We knew that it was going to be utilised in a different way later on in the film. And you're right, John, I think it was good to see both of them going, you know, hammers and tongs, as we say here, you know, just going for it with the lightsaber battle. Something I think they've kind of danced around in. Well, The Force Awakens, you can excuse Rey's inexperience with a lightsaber at this point. She's still learning, you know, who she is and what her, you know, capabilities are.
She's still not the best lightsaber.
No, she kind of wields it. You know, she's more of a wielder.
A bit jabby.
Yeah, and I think that's more Palpatine style as well. Yeah. So you're getting early clues there as well that, you know, she kind of, as you said, she's more of jabbing it, you know, and wielding it rather than being that, you know, very skilled in the sense of like Anakin or Obi-Wan Kenobi. So, yeah, I thought it seems played out pretty well. I think it was also a clever move on JJ's part that normally when someone who's, you know, that powerful within the Force, when they pass away, they vanish. At this point, she didn't, and we'll get to find out later on why.
I'm convinced that she enabled that Han Solo sequence.
Yeah.
And obviously, we had it revealed prior to the movie. There was leaks that he was back, and people were moaning about how can Han be a Force projection? He's not a Jedi. Yeah. How's it worked? Well, now we know that it was in actual fact Leia using every last modicum of power within her very being, if you'd like, to bring Han Solo before his son.
Yeah.
And he knows that she knew, obviously, that he was probably racked with guilt over what he did, and that was the one thing that could bring him back.
It was some,
his father saying,
some great
okay.
acting as well, John, Adam Driver. Harrison Ford's a great actor anyway, but that line, you know, it's quite emotional, you know, when he wants to say to his father, I love you, you know, and he just says, Dad, and then he stops because he's, you know, so choked. And Harrison Ford just delivers the I know line once more, you know. It's his last word he says, you know, in the franchise.
Because it's one of the things that's just completely synonymous with the character.
So it was a nice touch, yeah.
Stephen, I was going to get into, obviously, Adam Driver. I think he is the standout performer in this movie. Yeah. I don't know if you agree with me.
I do, yeah.
Sublime. He's been the best actor of the newcomers throughout. I did think Oscar Isaac was okay, but as we've said before, Paul, completely underutilised. John Boyega's a great young actor too. Finn could have been killed off in The Last Jedi. Daisy Ridley, she's okay, but she's not going to win any awards anytime soon.
No.
I feel she has to go off and maybe learn the craft a bit more without being too...
No, I think that's a fair comment, John. I think before The Force Awakens, she wasn't, you know, an established actor. She hadn't done a feature film yet, so I don't think it's unfair to say that, you know. And I think she'd probably be the first one to admit it as well, because I think she had a hard time with J.J. Abrams in The Force Awakens as well, where he was very brutal with her in those very early... Yeah, I mean, you loosen up a bit, you know. But I can understand that, John. I mean, I think anyone getting into that kind of profession has to learn their trade, and it's very hard getting in and doing a Star Wars film as your first film, because... you know, the likes of Harrison Ford, Mark Hamill, Carrie Fisher all had, you know, television parts, etc. Yeah. Well before Harrison Ford on a few films as well. But there was also that experience, you know, within that three. Daisy Ridley's came from nowhere, so I think she's done okay. She's not going to be the greatest actor in the world or anything. I don't think she's going to progress further than she's already got, to be honest with you. I doubt it very much. She's not like a young, you know, child actor or anything like that. So, well, no, and I'm not doing a disservice there, John. No. I think she's well within her comfort zone within Star Wars now.
Yeah, and to be fair, Stephen, she has tried to branch out and do different things, also with Murder on the Orient Express and whatnot. But yeah, you've seen it, Stephen, with Rick Dalton, and obviously Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, that sequence, the pressure it's on actors to nail the lines, to recite everything they've got in their head, and do it well and make it believable.
Yeah, without having a meltdown.
Without having a meltdown.
John, we have meltdowns on this show, you know, and we're only a YouTube channel with... we do it, you know. We all, you know, we do it all the time, you know, but I'm not comparing ourselves to Star Wars actors in any means, but you're right, I think the intensity, you know, and that was a good example, John, the Rick Dalton scene, you know, the one where the pressure's all on him.
Yeah,
you know, and I think she would have felt the pressure on that first film, especially with the director being so, you know, hard on her, but I think it was for her own good.
Stephen, what did you make about the redeeming of Kylo Ren as well? Do you feel like this was handled correctly? Did it anger you? Because I know you in particular weren't overly infused at the thought of maybe redeeming, or maybe I'm wrong, maybe I've just been reading other people's opinions and I'm putting John, them on you. I personally wanted to see him be redeemed because I just feel he was my favourite character in this trilogy by a mile. He was the most fleshed out character, the most nuanced character, he had the most stuff going on. Maybe along with Ray, she did have some internal stuff going on as well, but I was glad to see him being redeemed. And again, you speak about the acting of a man. I've seen people actually touch upon it, and I noticed it myself watching the movie. When he actually becomes Ben at the end, and he has his grandfather's lightsaber, he's actually acting physically different as well. He's holding the lightsaber differently, he's fighting differently.
Yeah.
So that was really cool to see that physical side, him showing as a transformation. I thought that was really neat. What was your thoughts on his redemption?
Yeah, John, I always maintained if the character was going to be redeemed in any fashion, it would have been self-sacrifice. I was wrong. You know, I never thought for a minute that the Han Solo scene was going to be recreated, but taking a different spin with the lightsaber, his lightsaber, the one with the bits on the side, being thrown away. I never foreseen that. I didn't think Harrison Ford was going to be in the film, so it worked. And I think your theory as well that Leia projected that sort of situation onto Ben Solo to make him realise that there is still good in him. It worked well. It didn't appear forced.
No.
You know, it wasn't jarring. I didn't think, oh, come on, that was such a quick turn. Like Anakin in Revenge of the Sith, I always felt the turn of Anakin was too forced. It was too quick. And he's, 5 minutes before he's grassing on Palpatine to Mace Windu, 5 minutes later he's kneeling.
I don't like that scene, but
just the timing of it, I think, was all wrong. In this instance, it wasn't. There was a gradual change. He always had the conflict in him. They always wanted the audience to know that he wasn't all gone. The only thing, obviously, was the contradiction from Luke was that he did say that he couldn't save Ben. Didn't mean that he couldn't be saved.
Yeah,
he
from just a couldn't do
it.
Point of view, yeah.
So that kind of tied into it as well, you know, and it was always going to be someone like either Leia or Han. I thought it was going to be Leia. I think if perhaps Carrie Fisher had survived, you know, and she had lived to make the film, I think it would have probably turned out different. She would have been the one to redeem him, but in a sense, she did.
You know? And Stephen handled it very well because it was actually her voice that stopped him from striking down Rey, perhaps confirming that he's all out dark, he's never coming back. And then we get that double-edged sword of him, her saying his name, connecting with him, saying, look, I'm still with you. Then also he sees his father as well.
Yeah.
And that brings him back to the light. I really enjoyed it. I thought that was pretty cool. One of the better things in the movie. Amidst some issues, let's just say, one of the issues, Steve, I'm going to get into it again, the Knights of Ren. Yeah. I've said here, was there any point to them? No, there wasn't, in truth. And that's my opinion. They just stalked around, doing nothing really. The one time they do anything of note, it's holding up Kylo at the end of the movie when we want him to go in and help Rey.
Yeah.
And I'm like, you useless bitches, you've did nothing the whole movie and now you're getting in his way, and he just swipes him aside.
Yeah.
Really, once he gets to Saber, that's it. It's
John, even the look of them is not that memorable. Mm-hmm. I mean, there was a scene where it was a kind of one of those flying shots. I don't know if it's like a helicopter or something like that, but it's kind of circling around them from a high distance. All I was looking for was Kylo Ren and amongst them. He wasn't there, but I didn't know that at that point. I wasn't that interested in them. That they could have been something, but they weren't, John. I don't think their introduction should have been in the middle part of the story in the sequel trilogy. Rian Johnson decided not to utilise them in any way, which I thought was a shame. I thought this would have been their film along with Kylo Ren. But it wasn't to be. You know, I think these characters are going to be set up for some kind of animation or maybe comic series. I don't know. They'll be used for something somewhere down the line, but the way they were utilised in this film was, there was no point to them, to be honest with you.
Yeah, and then you've got the Mike Zero theory, completely debunked, where they were fighting in some big elaborate battle with Poe and Finn and Maz Kanata's pirates. That never happened. No Maz Kanata pirate was seen in this movie, unless they were on one of those incredible amounts of ships that appear to save the day. Or they don't really do anything anyway. That's something we'll get into shortly.
Well, sometimes Mike gets things wrong, and sometimes it gets them wrong.
Yes, in a sense, yes. But then obviously Stephen Rey escapes from the Death Star ruin. She's in a strange place. She goes off in his TIE Interceptor to Act 2. She burns the Interceptor. She goes to throw Anakin's lightsaber into the fire. And who catches it but none other than Mark Hamill himself in all glowy blue, sparkly blue, as I think Jar Jar says in one of those robot chicken Star Wars things. He's all sparkly blue. He catches the lightsaber.
His hair's grown as well. I think he's put straighteners around
him
as well.
It's like Hitler's waxwork dummy in Madame Tussauds. The hair grows after death in spirit form. But he says to her, I can't recall the exact line, I'm heavily paraphrasing, that's no way to treat a Jedi's weapon or something like that. Yeah. Was that a dig at Rian Johnson, yep. Stephen? Amongst a great array, because before that we see the General Holdo. Why don't we pull the Holdo manoeuvre? And I think that's a million dicks.
Yeah, John.
What was your take on that?
I think there's always been these sort of tongue-in-cheek, lines that have been directed to certain people. I think even George Lucas didn't escape it with the Poe Dameron line. I think it was actually Max von Sydow's line, this will begin to make things, better or whatever.
That was always
that was obviously a dig at the prequels. But it's one of those lines that...
How wrong were they?
That I think perhaps I was just happy to see Luke back in some fashion, because I think it took that long to get him into the film. I was starting to have doubts that Mark Hamill was going to appear in the film, because there was obviously he's been keeping a low profile over the last year or so. For someone that's such a, not so much a big Star Wars fan himself, he hates watching himself, he's always admitted that, but he's always been part of the sort of promotion of the franchise, up till obviously The Last Jedi. So, and I wasn't sure if there was maybe a major fallout, we weren't getting to see him. Just going back, John, to the scene where we see Rey juggling the rocks in the forest and doing that sort of meditation thing. This sequence we're about to talk about now, John, kind of makes up for that. We were all thinking, Luke couldn't even do that with one stone. Well, he does get some redemption in this scene, obviously, with the, raising the X-Wing out of the sea, that he'd left there from the previous film. So it was nice to see that. It was nice to see a smile on his face as well, because obviously, the character, the way he was handled, a lot of people didn't like. I didn't like it either. I didn't like the way that Luke was portrayed or his attitude towards, what had come before.
The hubris of the Jedi.
I just think, it's one of these characters that was always filled with hope, and we got glimpses of that in this film. He was more upbeat. He was more accepting of Rey's heritage as well by saying, "You're a Palpatine," and he wasn't up and down about it, to be honest with you. I think it was maybe Leia had said a line, you're your own person. I can't remember what the line was, but it was really just to remind her, doesn't matter where you came from. I mean, look where Luke and Leia came from, Anakin Skywalker. So I think so. And I think the whole sequence was great, and I loved the Yoda theme coming through as well when they was, raising the X-Wing from the sea as well. I think it was just, it gave the character some closure as well. We obviously get to see him, later on in the film as well with Leia, but that scene was really set up for Mark Hamill. I think it was to, appease the fans as well, a little bit more redemption for the character. So, and I liked the fact he went back to Act 2, and obviously she got to interact with her master.
Yeah, and as we're always saying, Stephen, Star Wars is like poetry in motion. It keeps repeating itself. We see that with him, as you did say, lifting the X-Wing out of the water. That's like, he couldn't do it. Was it Empire Strikes Back? Before he's off the Bespin. And now he can do it one-handed as a Force Ghost. So, yeah, that was a nice little payback. And there was lots of fan service in this movie. It's been used like it's a dirty word, Stephen. I don't think the fan service was that jarring to me. I mean, someone says it, you're saying that like it's a dirty word. This is 40 years of storytelling coming to an end. You have to have a degree of fan service in there. No one seems to have an issue with the MCU utilising fan service all the time. It's not a dirty word, as long as it's not at the expense of good storytelling.
One thing
you can say about this movie, Stephen, it's not amazing, the storytelling. It really does, again, rejig lots of things we've seen before. You hadn't hinted at it, that it's not really went anywhere, this trilogy. No. I don't know if we actually spoke about it on the show, but
No, we didn't.
Yeah, but off the show, it's not really went anywhere.
Well, we were standing outside the theatre, John, last Sunday night, and in the freezing cold. And it was one of the things that popped into my head right away was that what did this sequel trilogy actually serve? Because I don't mean that in a bad way or anything like that. There was obviously moments in this sequel trilogy I really liked. There was some bits that I really hated. But as far as the narrative and the way the story was carried forward from the original trilogy, we got to see one of the kids from the original three development in Ben Solo, Kylo Ren, and that was probably the best bit about the trilogy. Ray, to an extent, yeah, I think she had conflict in who she was. She didn't know where she fit into the story. We didn't, also, you know, and I think as well as her learning where she came from, the audience did as well. That was always the trick about Star Wars, was that there was always a character that would be the audience's sort of eyes and ears. Ray was that, but for me, it didn't really move the story of Star Wars along in any fashion and get anywhere. No. That I really thought was worth three films worth, if you know what I mean. No. So that is what it is, you know.
Stephen, look, I've seen someone speak about it, and they're absolutely right. The Force Awakens was like a soft reboot for new audiences, a new generation. This is Star Wars. Try to differentiate itself from the prequels,
yeah,
which were a bit of a dirty secret at that point. Then we go into The Last Jedi, and Rian Johnson completely discards many of the story setups from JJ. Does his own thing, kills off the big bad in the middle movie. Doesn't really deal with the issue of, obviously, race, parentage or lineage. So that becomes a big secret into the final movie, which I felt was incorrect. Should have revealed what her real lineage was. Perhaps he did, and JJ thought, you know what, I don't agree with that, I'm retconning it. She's a Palpatine. Maybe that was genuinely what Rian wanted. He wanted her to be an Obi-Wan. And then, obviously, we go into this third movie, and it's too late. There's too much rushing about trying to solve it. I think he did a not too bad job then, but it really does. It shows it's discombobulated, this trilogy as a whole. And you're absolutely right. I don't think it really went anywhere as a whole. But yeah, I'm going to move on, Stephen. I've not got much more to add to that little segment. We'll go into the finale of this movie. And it feels very much like a rip-off of The Return of the Jedi, the throne room. Rey goes to Exegol, whatever it's called. Obviously, she confronts Sheev Palpatine himself. Or is it Sheev? Is it some puppet master who's been alive for 20,000 years and there's just playing all these clones about? I don't know. We'll get into that, I'm pretty damn sure. What was your thoughts on the ending of this movie, Stephen? This, obviously, back and forth between Rey and Palpatine, Kylo or Ben Solo coming down and try to save the day, and we've got essence, force essence getting transferred, and there's a kiss. We've got lightning up in the sky, cackling, maniacal cackling for Ian McDermott. What did you make of this ending? Did this make up for the rushed, choppy beginning and middle of this movie? What was your thoughts on it?
It was very much Return of the Jedi, John. It was, you know, I think the opening up the sort of skylight thing that, you know, to show Rey what was the situation was in space. Yeah, you know, your friends, it's all connected to, you know, this is the thing that I always laugh about with Jedi. Having, you know, the Jedi not having attachment, you know, when they clearly do, you know. Luke had it in Return of the Jedi, you know, he was conflicted, they drew his lightsaber towards the Emperor for Darth Vader to, you know, defend. And it was the same in this, in some kind of fashion. Yeah, they all have it, you know, they all have that, you know, contradictions within them. And this was wasn't any different. I felt the sort of way that the Emperor was coming back to life was pretty cool, you know, the glowing eye. I thought that was very well done. And it kind of explained the sort of state that Palpatine was in, you know, previously, that he wasn't fully there. You know, it was a kind of a host, you know, his remains. You know, you saw the sort of rotten fingers, you know, the bones had sort of, you know, were all rotten away. And, you know, as he was drawing the essence out of both Ben and Rey, you know, you saw that he was getting sort of rejuvenated, you know. Obviously, his fingers were coming back and all that kind of thing. That was obviously Force Lightning that did that. But I think, as a whole, it was a bit drawn out. It was something we'd already seen. The best bit about that sequence was actually when Rey was lying flat on the floor looking up to the sky, you know, looking at stars, and we heard all the sort of voices of Jedi past.
Yeah.
We got Mace Windu in there. I think we got Qui-Gon as well. Certainly got Anakin. Yeah, so there was ones from the animated stuff as well. Yeah, that really hacked a lot of people off when they saw the closing credits. I saw that leaked, actually, John, the closing credits. I was very disappointed we didn't get to see Hayden Christensen and, you know, making one final appearance as Anakin Skywalker. Well, we kind of did in audio, but I would have preferred to have seen it.
And there was a chance, you know, for him?
There was, you know, and I think, you know, that was always the emphasis on Revenge of the Sith, you know, with Qui-Gon learning how to do that trick, you know, and Obi-Wan learning it, but he didn't come back in any fashion. It's always going to be the case when you've not got the original actor. Yes, they've got Ewan McGregor, but he's the younger version. He wasn't the one that passed away, you know, into the Force. It was obviously Alec Guinness's. Alec Guinness's voice was used in there as well. I think it was the Ray, yeah, audio again. So steps, yes. I think that bit was pretty cool. But I think you know, the using the two lightsabers, you know, Leia's lightsaber and Luke's lightsaber as well, symbolism, to counteract, yeah. Obviously was symbolism, John. It was to say, you know, the Skywalkers are reunited here. You've got Rey, who's an adopted Skywalker. You've got Ben Solo in there, who is, you know, a Skywalker through blood, and you've also got the lightsabers representing Luke and Leia, you know, the twins.
Yeah.
So it kind of ties in nicely with the title of the film as well. I just felt it was a bit drawn out. I actually was more interested in the battle scenes, which is a reverse of what I'm normally like with Star Wars films. The battle scenes normally get in the way of the good sort of story with the Emperor's throne room in Return of the Jedi, which I didn't really want to be taken away from. I was kind of getting annoyed with flashing back between Endor and, you know, the space scenes with Lando. I just wanted to concentrate on that. In this one, it was the reverse. I wanted to see if anyone's going to come out and help them. We certainly got that, and we got Wedge in there as well for 2 seconds.
Yeah, 2 seconds. Yeah. Didn't really look like Wedge, but yeah, that's what happens. Age catches up with everyone, and it catches Dennis up with Lawson. Billy Dee Williams as well, Stephen, because someone says that they felt like didn't really know where he was.
I know what you mean, yeah.
That he was kind of a laughing hysterically while everything's going shit round about him.
Yeah.
Also, the lightning's bringing ships down from the Resistance, and he's just laughing away with Chewie and the co-pilot next to him. And then we have space horses running along the Star Destroyer.
Yeah.
That was another thing. It was a little bit jarring. Yeah, the telecom communications thing, they just switched it to General Pride's ship, and then that gets taken down.
I think we should talk about Finn's force sensitivity as well here, John, because this is obviously the point where it's getting highlighted its most. It kind of gives us a flashback to what he was about to say to Rey before they went under the sand earlier on.
Is that
all
revealed?
I think John Boyega on Twitter actually confirmed it wasn't he was going to say I love you, which he totally knocked in the head. So I think it was going to be that, John, obviously.
Yeah, I'm convinced.
Yeah, I think it is,
convinced.
Yeah.
I'm absolutely convinced he's force sensitive, and we may see some separate movie in the future with him becoming a Jedi. It's just the fact he could wield that lightsaber so well. I know that the Stormtroopers in this era were given extensive melee combat training, but absolutely, I think he's a Jedi. But yeah, Stephen, that end sequence, you're right, it was a little bit drawn out. I liked the interaction between the Emperor and obviously Rey, but there was moments I was cringing at a little bit as well, where he's saying, strike me down, strike me, and things like that. And look, I love Ian McDiarmid, but it just seemed like a rehash of Return of the Jedi. Very predictable. When you see the Force Essence swapping it in the middle and at the beginning of the movie to heal and whatnot, when obviously she drops dead, you know Kylo's going to save her. Then you get the kiss, I wasn't really interested in that. He brings her back. I'd have rather he just lived and let her die.
I don't remember the cast, John, I've got to be honest with you.
It'd have been more like the Rise of Skywalker if he was to survive and Rey was to sacrifice herself, but wasn't to be. Getting into the final sequences, though, Stephen, we finally get a wrong rated. 42 years later, Chewbacca gets his medal from Maz Kanata.
Yeah.
What was that about? How did she have the medal?
That's I think it was Han's medal, wasn't it? But then again, how did she have Luke's lightsaber as well? So, or Anakin's lightsaber? Yeah, I think she's just one of these people, you know,
she's got red, she gets things.
Yeah, she's a collector. I think it was a nice scene, John. I think it was one of those little bits of fan service, like you said, you know, why did Chewie never get a medal? Well, he didn't technically get a medal for, obviously, his heroics. It was obviously Han's medal that was getting passed down to him. Obviously, Leia had kept it. And it was a nice little touch. I think there was another touch, you know, that was quite emotional when Leia passed.
Yeah.
You know, Chewie's breakdown. I thought that was quite heartwarming. You know, and I think you know, the passing of Ben as well. I suppose we'll get into now as well. You know, you just has after the kiss. I think it was. You know, he just vanished into the Force.
Yeah.
We get to see Leia doing exactly the same. She couldn't obviously rest. You know, or pass on till our son was at peace as well. So I thought that was nice. It was a nice bit of story that, you know, they told visually. You know, they didn't have to obviously give you exposition on why her body was in state, you know, why it wasn't passing on. It was all done in that scene.
Yeah, absolutely, Stephen. I'm getting lost in my own little world there.
Yeah.
All in all, Stephen, I don't really care about how Maz Kanata got the medal. I don't really care that Chewie gets it.
No.
But you're right, it's more like a significance of the relationship. He's lost everyone, really. Just got Lando left.
And C-3PO.
And C-3PO, yeah. He got his memory wiped. That was
I think I would rather have nobody.
Yeah. There was no point to him having his memory wiped either. They made a big song and dance about just one last time to see my friends, and then R2 just gives him his memory back.
Yeah, I'd be like, whatever.
Yeah, whatever. But yeah, Stephen, yeah. All in all, also the final sequence as well, the Force Ghost sequence with Leia and Luke on the homestead, that was nice. And then nice little reworking of Rey's theme. I just thought John Williams as a whole did a smashing job. His last time composing a Star Wars movie, it was wonderful. He really made it special again. A couple of little reworkings. We have the Vader with the little toy box thing. It was like Return of the Jedi again, and obviously he's lying dead. Or was it when he was getting burnt on the stake? I can't recall, or whatever the hell it was.
I think it was on the Death Star when he took his mask off. Yeah.
So there was lots of little reworkings. I thought he did a great job as well. End sequence, missed opportunity for Anakin not to be there, with perhaps even...
And Ben,
Ben being there alongside, obviously, Luke and Leia. But it was a cool and sequence.
Shmi, yeah.
And Shmi, not Shmi, no. What was that line she says again? I always forget it.
You've brought
hope to those who have none, yes.
Yeah, you had no hope, Hen.
Yeah, you had no... No, she'd get killed by the sand people, and he killed them because they're animals, but not just the men, but the women and the children as well. More and more I think about it, Stephen, the more I actually appreciate the prequels. But look, we are running out of time here, Stephen, dramatically. What was your thoughts on that end sequence? Very, very briefly. And then just as a final thing, overall thoughts on this, has it damaged the legacy of Star Wars as a whole, the Skywalker saga? And has it changed the way you view the original trilogy?
No, John. I think, without sounding like a petty person or anything like that, you know, you can segment these stories, you know, as much as you want. You can either take it as a whole saga, or if you want to, you know, if you're a prequel lover, I'll just take the prequels. If I'm an original, I'll take them. I'll take them like that, you know. I don't think it ruined it. I think once they announced they were doing an episode 7, that kind of did that anyway, you know, and it was how well they were going to do it. There were some highlights in there, John, that I really enjoyed from this trilogy. I will be honest with you. There was a little bits that I felt may have just dampened some of the events of the original trilogy as well. But it was always going to be the case once they announced they were doing a sequel trilogy anyway.
Absolutely, Steve. The final thing I would add, I don't think it's dampened my enjoyment of the original trilogy. Because I can always watch that as a compartmentalised story anyway.
Yeah.
But I don't think it's added anything either. I don't think he saved the legacy of this sequel trilogy. As I said earlier, discombobulated shambles of a trilogy, really. No creative, unified vision. All over the place. Big mistake not having some sort of a story to tell.
Yeah.
But look, it is what it is. It's done. And yeah, I thought it was okay, the movie. I didn't think it was the world's best movie ever made. It's certainly not the worst Star Wars movie.
It will not be
ever.
Making our top 10, John.
It will not be making our top 10 of 2019. Not a chance. Not even close. But it's not the worst Star Wars movie ever made. Not when you have Ewoks, whatever the hell it is. Camp, what the hell was that called? It doesn't even matter.
Oh, the Caravan of Courage.
Caravan of Courage, yes. It's not as bad as the Attack of the Clones either. Certainly not as bad as that Clone Wars animated movie. But look, guys, I ain't got much more to add. Steven's not got much more to add. What did you make of The Rise of Skywalker? What was your thoughts on the movie? Did you think it was okay, good, shit, brilliant, amazing? If you have anything to say about it, you can comment below and let us know what your thoughts are down below in the comment section. You can also like the video if you've enjoyed it. It's been lengthy, but I had to save a bit. You can also subscribe to the channel too if you're enjoying content like this. And if you do, then you will get more of us again on a more regular basis. Lord knows when the next show will be, because it is the holiday season, but we'll be back at some point with a top 10 video for 2019.